My name is Alex Matthews. I'm the National Chair of Restore the Fourth. We're a civil liberties group that opposes unconstitutional mass government surveillance. And I also run our local chapter here in Massachusetts. I've been advocating in the Massachusetts Legislature for several years on issues relating to surveillance and police accountability, asset forfeitures, body-worn cameras, police militarization, wiretapping, that sort of thing. So I wanted to start off the discussion by talking about some of the broad myths that we may have about the Massachusetts Legislature, which I certainly started off 5 years ago with having. One thing that a number of people have commented onto is that anyone can propose a bill in the Massachusetts Legislature. And that is a right guaranteed by the Massachusetts Constitution. Now, this is true, and in an open government way and an accessibility way, that is kind of good. But that fact serves as the fuel for a number of problems that the legislature faces during the course of its legislative calendar. And I should say at this point that the legislative session starts at the beginning of 2017, and so we're 3 months into it as of the date of this speech. And it's a 2-year session, so it runs through to 2018, and then they start again in January of 2019. So anyone can submit a bill, as it says up there. Anyone can get, and every single bill gets a hearing. So there will be some point where a committee of the legislature holds a hearing, and a bill that you want to submit is going to be there. It's going to be on the agenda. You may not get a lot of notice that there's going to be a hearing, but it will be on the agenda, and you will have, as a member of the public, 3 minutes to talk about your bill. Now, for some activists who are interested in starting off on legislative work, that really is what they are interested in. They want to have those 3 minutes in front of a legislator, but it's important to give something of a context to what this means. So, in this current legislative session, and as a matter of general practice in the Massachusetts legislature, they don't know if you are trying to propose a bill by yourself, as is your right, Massachusetts citizen, you can propose a bill, that is fine. If you propose it without having the support of a legislature, if you do what's called a by request bill, then the legislature, then your legislator, your state rep, or your state senator will submit it on your behalf. And they'll put a note at the top saying it's by request, which shows that they don't themselves necessarily support it. And that note, by request, is the kiss of death. If you submit a by request bill, then when it comes up for your committee hearing, for your 3 minutes, then the legislators will just be ticking off time until they can get to the real matter that they're there for. Because they take a by request bill as a signal of the bill matter being so unpopular or so unrealistic that you weren't even able to get one legislator to put their name on it, honestly. And so it's an incredibly bad quality signal from the perspective of legislators. So, when it comes to annoying legislators for freedom, that part is going to come a little later. If you want to submit anything that has a chance of being listened to seriously, then you need to have a bill sponsor who is a legislator. There are a few cases where non-legislators sponsor and it works, like if it's a sheriff or the attorney general, that tends to get a lot of notice. But then there will usually be legislators sponsoring as well. So please, 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 if you have one takeaway from this, do not think that part of your political strategy should be submitting a bill by request, because that's going to go nowhere. So the quantity of bills is a major concern, because anyone can submit them. But finding a sponsor is enormously important. So who can you find? I mean, are you starting off with contacting the legislator? Everyone in Massachusetts has their own legislator, but your own legislator may be completely uninterested in what you have to offer. So who are you going to look to? Well, the way that I characterize it is that there are two kinds of legislators. There are the policy people and there are the power people. And examples of these two are up there. On the left is Rep. Denise Provost, who I've worked with a bunch and who has sponsored bills for me. And I'm very grateful for that. And on the right is Representative Tom Stanley of Waltham. Now, policy people and activists honestly have a lot in common. They may not necessarily support the same policies, but the reason why policy people get involved in politics is to advance a particular policy agenda. They're interested in what government can do, what it should be doing, what it should not be doing. And that means that they are able to be affected by the kinds of appeals that activists tend to make. This is a good bill. It's going to help people. It's going to make people better off. It's going to advance justice. It's going to advance freedom, which is what our bills hopefully do. So for policy people, their interest lies in trying to put this kind of stuff into effect. And if you're lucky, you'll find a legislator who is willing to work with you on language that will actually help put the desired outcome into effect in Massachusetts. And that is great. The difficulty is that, as in any legislature, the people who tend to gravitate towards leadership, the people who tend to have the most influence, are the power people. And power people might as well be a different species in terms of how they're trying to, or why they want to get involved in politics. Because it can be kind of like the family business. Rep. Tom Stanley, son of Mayor Tom Stanley of Waltham, he got into politics because his family was in it, and he's doing fine. You know, he gets consistently re-elected, but it couldn't be said that policy is his real driving force. So politics being about the distribution of power as much or more as it is about what actually gets passed is a difficult thing for activists to come to grips with. But it is important. So for the introduction of the bill, it is easier to work with policy people to find a sponsor for most of the stuff that you or I might be interested in. Hey, don't. But for the later passage of a bill, getting power politicians on board becomes very important. Now, you will find often that for the policy people, they have a contentious relationship with leadership, because they tend to be a little more stubborn about voting their particular way, because they're in politics because they care about principle. And so in the case of Denise Provost, and I respect her immensely for this, she refused to vote for an extension of the term of the Speaker of the House. And she was one of only 11 legislators who refused. But that principled refusal is not going to make her necessarily get the committee assignments that she wants, or get the leadership assignments, or the chairmanship of committees. And so at a base level, people who get vice chairmanships or chairmanships of committees on Beacon Hill are going to be more likely to be power politicians and are more likely to want to fight for their team as much as for a particular policy. Now this is going to become important later when we talk about some of the committee dynamics. Next slide, please. So the way the legislative calendar begins is you have 2 years, and there is a narrow window at the beginning of 2 years when you can submit bills. It is 1 month in January, and And all legislators are facing this. It's a massive rush every year. What you need to be doing is to have that legislative calendar in mind and to be aware, okay, new legislative session starts at the beginning of 2019, therefore in the summer of 2018 I need to be reaching out to legislators and finding potential sponsors and getting the text lined up so that in this tiny narrow window in January you can actually submit the text and have a chance of it getting meaningful support. For working on co-sponsorships, there is then a window of time in which members of the House can sign on as co-sponsors for your legislation. And that typically closes around the end of January or the beginning of February. Senators have a privilege, which means that they can sign on to bills at any time. But senators in this process matter less, and we'll also get to that. So there's a narrow window, and if you want to... So there's a narrow window, and if you want to get something passed outside of that time, it is very difficult. Typically, it would be budgetary legislation, it would be emergency legislation. There's a whole process that the governor and the legislators go through, but we're talking here about how the public and how activists can get involved, and so this is the window that we have. Now the volume of bills is incredible. There are over 6,000 bills submitted in a typical legislative session. It's sometimes been as high as 7,000. Partly this is because a certain proportion of them are these by-request bills that any person is submitting, but that have no realistic prospect of support or passage. But even if you strip out the by-request bills, which legislators would tend to do, then there is still a hellaciously large number of bills. And legislators feel like the guy in the Jeep. They are trying to get on top of an enormous variety of legislation within a very short space of time. We've just gone through that with them for the January of 2017 session. And so they're trying to master an enormous amount of text, figure out whether they're going to sponsor something, figure out whether they're going to co-sponsor something, which is why it's good to get in ahead of time. In this case, getting in the second half of 2016 and talking calmly at a quiet time for the legislature with some good policy people who may be willing to file your bill. And that gets you out a little more ahead of this avalanche of bills that is being faced at the moment. What happens then is the bills all go to the clerk's office in the Senate and in the House, and the clerks file them by topic matter based really on the titles of the bills, and they put them in what they feel will be the appropriate committee. There are like 20 to 25 different joint committees of the legislature. And where your bill goes can affect it materially. In the case of the stuff that we work on, the Judiciary Committee is a more friendly environment for us than the Public Safety and Homeland Security Committee for civil liberties related bills. Given the choice, which we don't have, but if we had the choice, then sending bills to judiciary would certainly increase their chances of passage. Here's the other complication. You have to find, it's good to find a sponsor who is on the relevant committee, but you won't know what committee an individual legislator is going to be on, not with certainty. I mean, from session to session, there is some persistence in the membership of committees. But what committee you're on is 100% within the gift of the Speaker of the House or the Senate President. And so not annoying them is important if you want to continue on your committee. They like to shift things around in terms of who has pleased them and not pleased them over the course of the past session. And so, to some extent, it will be luck if you manage to file a bill that has a sponsor who ends up being actually on the relevant committee. So, February and early March, they do committee assignments for legislators, and then at about that point, they will assess, they will assign a permanent bill number to each bill, and they will put them up online. They generally do the Senate bills a lot quicker than the House bills because there are a lot more House bills than Senate bills. And when they finally go up online, then as activists, you can say, hey, there, here is H3585. We really want you to advocate on it. We really want you to call about it. And it's very difficult to do advocacy of the type of generating calls or having people go to offices of legislators in the February to March period of the legislative session, because there are no bill numbers to work with, and you're just talking about the title of a given bill. And then, because the subject matters that legislators are concerned about have some overlap, it can be very confusing for legislators until the point where the bill numbers are sorted out. We have now passed through that point in the legislative calendar, and now we are at the point where hearings are just starting in legislative committees. So, here is a committee hearing, and the point I want to emphasize is that this as a process has significant deficiencies as well. Flowing from the volume of the bills that are coming into the system. So I have seen Judiciary Committee hearings where they have had over 100 bills to consider at a single hearing. For public safety, I've seen committee hearings where they have 50 bills. For other smaller committees like consumer protection, it might be 10 or 20 at a time. But the point is, it's still going to be a lot in the course of a given legislative hearing. And it's going to be a frustrating process for getting people along to them. First, they generally are required to notice out a public hearing only 2 or 3 days beforehand. And so you have a campaign, you have a bill you want to get through, and you have literally no idea within a very long period of time when a hearing is going to come up. Basically, any of our bills that we have going in this session could come up for a hearing in between now and June of 2018. That's a year and a quarter. And so how do you mobilize around that? Second thing, unless it is a bill that is perceived as being a really heavyweight bill that is going to have a lot of speakers, typically the hearings are going to be scheduled for during the workday. And that produces its own set of issues for people who, you know, have jobs and have difficulty getting to those hearings. It is very difficult for them to participate easily in this hearing process. And when you get to the hearing, you can sign up, you can put your name down, and you can give your 3 minutes of testimony on a bill. But you're not going to be able to predict with much certainty when you're going to be called upon. That is because there are a lot of preliminaries before they get to public testimony. So they will have initial proceedings in among the committee members. Then they will have testimony from any legislators who have bills that they have sponsored and they want to come in and they want to push the bill in front of the committee. And that's understandable. It can take a while. I've seen it take a couple of hours. Then for any public safety personnel who are present, any police officers or firefighters who are present, then I've frequently seen it that they will take them next in line as a category so that they can get back to their very important jobs. And then at some indeterminate point, the public testimony will begin. So let's say that a hearing starts at 11 a.m. and you're worried about picking up your kids from school. It's very difficult to have predictability that you are definitely going to be able to pick your kids up from school. So that is a defect of the process. And they jump around from bill to bill during the public testimony because they're just taking the speakers in order that they sign up. They will take panels of speakers before anyone else often. but they will jump from topic to topic and come back to topics, like the transgender discrimination bill that I was at the hearing for last year. And so the topic would go transgender stuff, X, Y, Z, transgender stuff, A, B, C, D, transgender stuff. And so it's not like there's a little sort of, they don't block it off. They present an agenda with a list of bills, but that doesn't mean the bills are taken in order. So that there are significant hindrances in having members of the public come testimony and give public testimony. That being said, I really strongly encourage people to do so, because any other mechanism other than coming to the legislature and being face to face with legislators, the Massachusetts legislature is not really set up for. I would say that it is Massachusetts legislature 1.0, except that there aren't really numbers low enough for how untechnological the process is. And so you can call, and calling is nice, but it has so much less impact than going in face to face. You can write, and writing is nice, but same thing. If they're not getting to know you on a personal basis, it is very difficult to have an effect over the process. And this, of course, provides the mechanics for why it's very hard for the general mass of the public to get involved at the Massachusetts legislature, and why, for many legislators, the people who they actually see in their offices are sort of lobbyist, lobbyist, lobbyist. Oh, a member of the public. Lobbyist, lobbyist. Member of the public. And it also means that the members of the public who they do see are overrepresented among cranks with a lot of time. And I freely admit that on the topic of civil liberties, many people might apply that moniker to me, but it's just reality of these systems that they are going to deal with more members of the public with more time on their hands than they should have, and not necessarily with a representative set of the public and their concerns, particularly for low-income people, particularly for minority people. It's very challenging. Next thing to observe is a little bit of vote counting when it comes to the committee work. So most topics are dealt with by joint committees. Every joint committee has a certain number of House members and a certain number of Senate members. Now, first question, who can tell me which is bigger? Is it the House or the Senate?
The House is the
most. The House is bigger. It is much bigger than the Senate. What does that naturally mean about which has more members on a given committee, the House or the Senate?
Presumably the House.
Yes. There are far more House members on any given committee than senators. So, from the outside, we might look at senators and go, well, being a senator is more impressive than being a rep, and therefore it might be more important to get the support of senators on a given committee than House members. But that's not really so. The Senate is always, always systematically outnumbered on Beacon Hill. And it's a source of significant frustration to the Senate President that this is so. And so what this means is that even though it is usually the case that the Senate is to the left of the House politically, because they are outnumbered, it makes it systematically harder for progressive legislation to get through. When I started up this this advocacy 5 years ago for Digital Fourth, I made an incorrect assumption. And the assumption I made was that if your bill went before a committee, then the committee would vote on that bill after having a hearing. And that, I just assumed it. It seemed like it would naturally follow. It took me a while to realize that this was not, in fact, so. The committee chairs and vice chairs control everything. So there's a Senate chair and a Senate vice chair. There's a House chair and a House vice chair. And on a typical committee, they decide whether or not the bill that they have had a hearing for even comes up for a vote within committee on whether it should be reported out of committee. And the vast majority of bills that they consider are never chosen by the chairs or vice chairs as ones that are in this privileged minority of getting an actual vote in committee on whether they should go out, be reported out of that committee. So this gives chairs and vice chairs enormous control over the process, particularly the House chairs and the House vice chairs. And if you don't propitiate them or bring adequate pressure to bear on them, then your bill may never come up for a vote, but they're not even required to tell you whether it comes up for a vote or not. And if it comes up for a vote, they're not required to tell you anywhere which members of that committee voted for it and which members of that committee voted against it. This is information that would be kind of helpful for legislative advocacy, right? Because you'd want to go back to the people who voted against your bill and to go, why, tell me why, tell me what we can do to make you happy. You can't do any of that unless it's required for the chairs to release that kind of information. The Senate president introduced legislation that would have required that kind of reporting for all joint committees last session, and the Speaker of the House looked at that bill and went, nice try, fellas. And so that wasn't going anywhere last session. I'd be surprised if it went anywhere this session either. The age of the bill is also a relevant criterion. What chairs of committees want to see is that there is sustained enough public pressure for a particular bill or a particular issue that you can keep coming back session after session, pushing the same legislation, bringing speakers out, bringing people out to the public hearings, and showing that you care about it, and also that the legislation goes through something of a maturing process, like a fine wine, as it passes through. And so if your bill is what they call a bill of first impression, if this is the first legislative session that it's been introduced for, then it's not impossible that it's going to get reported out of committee, but it makes it much more unlikely that it's going to be reported out of committee. Chairs pay attention to this stuff, and they will look at, is this a bill of second impression? Even better, is it a bill of third impression? And there seems to be some sort of default unspoken assumption that if a bill reaches third impression, that maybe somebody should, you know, read it. And that will be after five years after it's initially introduced. There are exceptions. The example that I tend to cite to of an exception, I will get to a little later. But for most bills, what will happen to them is called getting sent to study. And that's a polite Massachusetts circumlocution for the bill is dead. There will be no actual study done. It's just that it will not be reported out to the floor in that legislative session. And with very rare exceptions, that is what happens to your bill in that session if it gets sent to study. So sometime after it comes up for a hearing, they will say, they will put up online that the bill has been sent to study, and then you try again next legislative session. There is a bill, a badly needed bill, on racial profiling, introduced by Byron Rushing and Sonia Chan-Diaz, at least that's who usually introduces it, and it has been around on Beacon Hill for well over a decade, and it keeps getting sent to study. If legislation offends significant interest groups, then it's more likely to be sent to study. Next slide, please.
What's the procedure for sending a bill to study?
It's just the chairs
doing it.
Yeah, it's just a classification process. Okay, this and this and this bill we're going to have a vote on. All the rest go in the circular file, which is labeled sent to study. Okay. Another factor that influences whether it's going to be sent to study or not is this a money bill? Obviously, currently we have a situation where we have a Republican governor in Massachusetts who has said that he doesn't want to see overall tax rises. And so people are aware that at the end of the process, if there is a bill that comes to the governor's desk that involves an increase of taxes, then the governor is going to be very reluctant to sign it. But in truth, even when we had a Democratic governor under Deval Patrick, this impulse against money bills still existed. And that was because it is often the case that the legislature finds itself having to absorb cuts proposed by the governor mid-year, and Patrick did this too. They're called 9C cuts. So there's an institutional bias against anything that involves spending more money. There is also an institutional bias against what they like to call unfunded mandates on localities. So if your bill isn't asking the state government to do anything, but if it's asking municipalities to do something and not allocating money to pay for it, then that tends to be something that will encounter resistance more than other types of bills. So money bills have more problems, unfunded local mandate bills have more problems. And so those are some of the institutional barriers here. Then, but the single most major institutional barrier is the personality and the beliefs of this guy. Does anyone recognize who this guy is? This guy is the most powerful person in Massachusetts. Bill?
DeLeo.
Bob DeLeo, Speaker of the House. Now, Speakers of the House have enormous power, and I've talked a little bit about it. They have power over every House legislator's career, and therefore, because most senators come out of the House, over every senator's career in the early part of their careers. Being on the right side of the Speaker makes a lot of difference to you in your committee assignments, in whether you can demonstrate that you're a successful legislator, and it's really hard to cross the Speaker for any reason, which is why there's been a historical pattern that Speakers of the Massachusetts House have served with an enormous amount of power only until they've died or have been indicted. No, has not died or been indicted yet. So if you want your bill to be a successful bill, then it really helps if you can appeal to Robert DeLeo and have it be something that he is interested in. He is the representative for Winthrop. So with any activist organization, your most useful members in Massachusetts are going to be the people who happen to live in Winthrop, or the people who know people who live in Winthrop, or the people who have visited Winthrop once. Be aware of that as a barrier. It's not like you can't get things done in the Senate, because things can be done in the Senate, but looking at his personality and his history and seeing what leverage can be brought to bear is important. So I've talked a lot about the institutional barriers at the legislature, and because of this, because of the difficulties in getting legislation passed, it has been a common practice and a useful practice for activists to look at ways of bypassing the legislature and going straight to the people with an initiative process. So you need to get tens of thousands of signatures in a variety of locations within Massachusetts in order to do that. But the advantage is that it is one of the few things that can materially shift the political discussion in a way that the House Speaker doesn't like. So the canonical example of this recently is the debate over legalization of recreational marijuana. And for the activists who are involved in that, there's a lot of frustration right now because they have succeeded in getting an initiative passed, And now it's going back to the legislature, and there are like 50 different bills that have been proposed that would dial back on the measure that would limit it in various ways. And because legislatures have legislative authority, it is always going to be the case that they are going to want to come back to things, particularly things that are controversial, particularly things that the House Speaker doesn't like. But what they are likely to be successful in as legislators is not going to be entirely overturning the will of the people as expressed through initiative, because the initiative to legalize recreational marijuana passed by a significant majority. It will have shifted the discussion, and it will have accelerated the process of legalizing recreational marijuana in Massachusetts significantly, and much more significantly than the legislature might have been willing to move on it if there were not the initiative process. So if you are an activist who is involved in an area that honestly is never going to appeal to Dalia, then you might want to orient your advocacy more around an initiative process than around an internal process at the legislature. There are other kinds of outside pressure that can be brought to bear. One very intense kind of outside pressure comes from the courts. And in the case of a bill that didn't take all of these years to pass, the one that comes to mind is when there was a ruling from the Supreme Judicial Court relating to someone on the tee who had been caught taking photographs of women's skirts. And the Supreme Judicial Court carefully reviewed the case and the relevant statute, and they realized that the relevant statute did not cover the conduct in question, and that therefore the person who was doing that would have to be released. You have never seen the legislature move so fast. It boggled the mind. Within 3 days, legislation had passed pretty much unanimously in House and Senate, had gone to the governor's desk and got signed that taking photographs of women's skirts was in fact illegal in Massachusetts. But that is the kind of thing that it takes to really short-circuit the process. Second thing that can accelerate the process, the progress of legislation, is publicity from the press. But I want to talk about that in a very limited way. What appeals to legislators most is avenues of communications that honestly activists don't always use that much. So activists are often focused more on the internet as a source for news, and what appeals to legislators more is often the more traditional forms of news dissemination, the TV news, letters and op-eds in their hometown papers specifically. So I don't know what the Winthrop local newspaper is called, but it is probably influential out of all proportion to its subscriber base. So having those kinds of news coverage is good. And so in terms of street activism, this is where that sort of thing can come out into play in terms of having positive coverage in those channels. I appreciate that there is an ongoing issue that when you run protests, the TV news is often disinclined to cover them relative to their importance. And when they cover them, if there is anything that goes wrong at any of them, then that becomes the whole story. So there are issues with this, but this kind of coverage is definitely noticed by legislators. And then another kind of outside pressure, if you're able to marshal it, of course, is financial pressure. It is helpful with a legislature to always to have contributed to their campaign, even if it is a very small amount, then you can at least be talking to them and saying, you know, hey, I'm a donor, I'm a constituent, this matters to me. When it comes to larger scale donations, there are of course people who play that game who tend to come from the top stratum financially in Massachusetts, but I'm going to assume that that is not a viable strategy for most activist organizations. So I'm just talking about at this level a symbolic amount done hopefully unconnected to the time that you're meeting with the legislator, but just so that you can say, you know, I gave to your campaign, you feel like a good guy to me, let's talk about what you could be doing. Activists on the whole we find it easier to build alliances with each other sometimes than to build alliances in the places and with the people who are going to matter to the legislature specifically. There are plenty of events where legislators meet the public, whether it be office hours or breakfasts or Rotary Club meetings or all sorts of ways that legislators connect with a certain slice of the public. Fundraisers are one of these. And honestly, I look at the St. Patrick's Day breakfast and I go, you know, this doesn't feel like it would be totally my favorite way to spend a breakfast in Massachusetts, but going to these things, making connections, sitting next to folks who don't necessarily have much experience of the activist scene, but who are connected into the currents of power in the legislature, is a way to help legislative advocacy specifically alone. This is not to say that it is the most important kind of outreach that you can be doing. Of course it isn't. It's just a kind of outreach that serves the particular end of getting a bill passed more effectively than some other kinds of outreach. I was working with a legislator who will remain unnamed, and I was working on a piece of police body cam legislation, body worn cameras for police officers. We had built up a really good partnership with a group called the Boston Police Camera Action Team in Boston. And we had thought together very carefully about the kinds of policies that would be appropriate for body cameras. And that legislator decided not to sponsor the bill that we had, in part because we were associated with that group, saying to me, well, the Boston Police Camera Action Team have been publicly critical of the police, so I think they're anti-police. Well, yes, I mean, if you're going to do legislation in this area, then it's to be expected that the people who are interested in bringing accountability to the police are people who are critical of the police. And that is completely legitimate. The criticisms that they had were not unreasonable at all. But perhaps what that shows is that it is difficult in a small c conservative institution like the legislature for legislators to understand the importance of the kind of work that we as activists can be doing to build movements across the barriers of race and of class, and to bring intersectional perspectives to the legislature. I'm not saying this applies to all legislators, but it shows that the inside voices and finding inside voices who can speak up inside the room is a challenge that we will just face in an ongoing way as activists in Massachusetts. And finding the right way to speak to legislators about issues that really matter remains a challenge. What I would say is that with all of these, this work to build up alliances and to build up relationships, it's profoundly important work. And to some extent, we expect so much more of the legislature than it is equipped at this point to deal with or to deal out. It's not a quick institution. It has choke points for legislation getting through that get worn down over time through steady advocacy. But they're not good at doing things quickly and at responding to the crises of the day in the way and with the speed that they should. But that does not mean that your legislation won't get passed. It just means that it will take longer to do so. And that can be a frustrating process, but it is immensely worth doing. And you don't necessarily need huge numbers of people to do it. You need people who are able to steadily keep plugging away at the process until they're willing to move your legislation forward. So those are the insights that I have garnered from several years of doing this. And I'd be happy to take questions and to explore some of these issues further.
Thank you. So, Mr. Marthews, how successful have you been at bills that you have proposed? Are there bills that you have actually gotten through legislature that have become law?
There have been bills that we have supported in partnership with other organizations that have come through and become law. So we were involved in the effort to pass public records reform in Massachusetts, for example. For the bills that we ourselves have authored, because we have only been involved in the process of filing bills, this is the second legislative session that we have done it. So our oldest bills are bills of second impression that we have authored ourselves. For those sole authored bills, those have not got through yet. So in that sense, I focus in this talk on the really most challenging element of it, which is becoming one of the few bills that gets reported out of committee, more than the later stages of the process.
How many people do you know from Winthrop, and do you make specific efforts to go up and meet Winthrop people precisely for the aforementioned reason?
So we currently have one person on our list who is from Winthrop. Winthrop is not a big town, but I have gone to meet with them and had them come into the legislature. But certainly active cultivation of people in Winthrop would be an advisable strategy for us to do more of in order to have more influence over the speaker. Okay, Jamie, I think we're done.
But that night, sir, what are the relevant questions should he be answering? I guess some level, of course, is a basic question. You know, okay, you've given us this background. How do we, as itty bitty little people, be effective? For the most part, you know, I'm just going to be following you or somebody who has, you know, put the time into it, and I'm just a soldier, you know, carrying the banner behind you. But
being effective, I think, given this analysis of the structure of the legislature, as I say, rewards persistence and in-person contact far more than any other thing, which is awkward because those are precisely the things that are difficult for people who are time-starved and under economic pressure and who are not available during the workday to provide. But those appear to be the qualities that are the most effective in getting lawmakers to listen.
How do you get a meeting?
A meeting with a legislator?
With a legislator.
Well, that is less complicated than some of the other stuff. Because you should, you can call up, House reps typically only have one staffer unless they're a chair or vice chair of a committee. And so calling up the staffer, if that doesn't work, going in and seeing if you can catch the staffer in. This works better for legislators who are located, whose districts are located closer to Boston. For legislators who are far out in Western Mass, then their staffers tend only to be in the building if there is a hearing that they are required to attend, or if there is a major floor debate that they are required to attend. And so for those legislators, it poses particular problems for Boston area activists because the only way to get the meetings is to go out into the districts and to meet with them there. But I've had successful meetings out in the districts where I've sort of identified a constituent who is on our list, asked them to make some time to come in and meet with their legislator in district and then met with them. And that's been helpful in building relationships. So in that sense, for any issue that you're working on in the state legislature, it rewards not being highly local to a particular area as an activist group, but having a list that can extend out into every area of Massachusetts.